So, what is an insurrection? Actually, do we want to start with that question? But before, given the film's called Insurrection,
nice name,
with an S, and when we first talked, we talked about our theory of insurrections, and admittedly, we don't have a theory of insurrections, right? It's sort of up to our characters, people like you, to sort of guide us through that. We're not making kind of a normative claim about this is what it is. So, are you going to be saying insurrection and riot as synonymous entities?
That seems like the question.
That is a good question. We can jump into, so maybe we can dive into that. And then once we dive into that, just as you know, here's the kind of ground rules. I will be interrupting. He may be interrupting at opportune moments to sort of have you re-say things, all of that good stuff. And it's right behind you, the water. You've already started it. Okay,
yeah.
Good. But before we start, I'm just curious, what do you think about that in general? Because I'd like to agree on that and not have it like a antinomy that's
Inja.
Like...
Inja, can you give me a hand real quick?
You want to agree that they're the same, or you want to...
No, I would just want to be clear on what our terms are before we dive into things so that we're not pontificating like theoretically for too much of this interview. I think our first interview was very theoretical, which was like my own fault. And for this interview, I think the general direction we want to go in is more...
Do you want double?
Yeah.
You got,
and I got another clip.
More straight to the heart right of the concept and
is that okay?
Clear follow through with it, as opposed to exploration of the on the corners of it and the sides and all of the angles. And I don't know if that makes sense.
I'm trusting it makes sense to you, and you should push me.
I'm gonna try to push. Yeah. I'll try to take that responsibility.
Yeah. I think you have more of a sense of.
We'll try to.
What counts is like. I no longer know what's theoretical and what's not. Like to me, it's just what I think. So, you feel free to push me.
Okay.
I'm not inclined to use insurrections and riots interchangeably, although I don't have a big theory about that. My sense would be, a riot is describable in the present tense, whereas naming something as an insurrection is probably retrospective and trying to attempt to understand whether it attained a certain political significance or not.
Okay.
So I think it would take a lot of work to call a sports riot an insurrection, for
Inja,
example.
He has a little hair. Actually, can you get the hair right there on your...
Sports riot would be very hard to call an insurrection, right? I'm going to go ahead and say all insurrections are riots, but not all riots are insurrections.
That's really nice.
I hope that's true. I feel like that's true right now.
Okay. Yeah, because what we were talking about before was
all insurrections involve a riot.
We were talking about like Black Lives Matter, and Black Lives Matter could become an insurrection if the group in New York meets on the highway with the group in DC, and then there's a certain spillover effect or something like that. That's another...
Yeah, if someone wanted to call what happened in Ferguson after Michael Brown got killed and the 2 weeks after that insurrection, I wouldn't be opposed to that at all. That itself, but it was a limited insurrection. You know, insurrections are limited. Insurrections are not revolutions.
Okay, great. So then what is an insurrection then?
I don't think there's a hard, in trying to account for what a riot is, I have a very specific definition of what a riot is in an attempt to solve some historical unclarities. But for insurrection, I don't think there's such a clear set of boundaries. It's an attempt to read kinds of street struggles as having a political content. And that involves, I think, context and what the effect turns out to be. Although, I mean, I think we'd agree that all riots have some political...
Have him
content.
Look at me. Hands down. My bad.
It's okay.
We're going to start that over anyways. Okay, so then... Sorry.
Good.
Why don't we do this? Why don't you restate that, but pivot to saying, for me, an insurrection is a category that's not as clearly defined as a riot, and then jump into what you consider a riot to be. So if you can just sort of make a bridge though by starting with insurrection, because we want that name to be introduced and then move to riot, which is obviously more clear for you.
Yeah.
So, please.
So, I think for me, insurrection is an optimistic term. I don't mean they don't exist. I mean that as soon as you give it that name, you have some sort of hope about it being politically significant at a substantive level. For me, it's less clearly defined than what a riot is. For me, the riot and the strike go as this historical pair, and you can really work out what they are, what the differences are. An insurrection could honestly arise out of a riot or a strike or both or a combination of them. It's when it reaches a certain level of intensity. Maybe you know more retrospectively when it turns out to have drawn a kind of massive response, been experienced as a political threat or a political opening, that we're more happy to say insurrection. Whereas riot, uprising, rebellion, these seem to me more clearly definable, more clearly local.
Right. And that then give us a little more on what a riot is as you have developed it.
So when I try to define a riot, this has been a historically contested category. People often want to define it according to a sense of violence and a certain amount of chaos. I think that's difficult, not least because strikes are historically extremely violent, and people tend to forget that in the modern era when they're more associated with a kind of ascetic downing of tools, that historically they too have been quite violent. So I don't think that distinction works very well. For me, and I draw this distinction largely from E.P. Thompson, the historian, maybe slightly modified, in his account, a riot is a struggle over the price of market goods. So if you think of the bread riots in the 16th, 17th, 18th centuries in the UK, France, all over the world, people are unable to afford to make their way in the world with their basic subsistence, and so they struggle to make things cheaper, and that is what we define as a riot. And when you have the rise of people working for a wage, struggles over how much work is worth, the struggle over the price of labor, that's what a strike is. And that's a pretty simple distinction. We could probably add some dimensions to it. So in a riot, it may involve workers, but they're not there as workers. Whereas in a strike, it involves workers who are there as in their role as workers. So that would probably define it further. But I think that's an incredibly useful set of distinctions that works very well for a lot of places and for a long period of history, but gets complicated in the recent past, most notably, and I think most obviously, because of the category that we've come to call somewhat uncomfortably race riots, which seem not to correspond to that tradition terribly well.
What's a race riot?
Well,
a race riot is, before it, you start.
A race riot is, in a United States tradition, of course it happens all over, but it's deeply identified with the United States. The earliest race riots were almost entirely went what we might now call the other direction. They were white populations preserving the subordination of populations of color. The earliest ones in the U.S., actually sort of famous ones in the late 19th century, had to do with Chinese laborers who were no longer needed to do labor and were still hanging around, and white populations would often descend upon them quite violently. Sometime in the middle of the 20th century, the valence or the direction shift, so that now when people say race riot, they tend to mean a riot started by usually African Americans, or seemingly started by maybe Latina Americans. The initiating event, and I think this is by now common knowledge, is almost always the police kill. In the contemporary scene, to choose the paradigmatic example, right, the police kill a black kid. And then, moreover, they seem to do so with impunity. Nothing happens to the cop. And that's when riot tends to break out most consistently in the U.S., usually along lines where the death of that kid and the fact that no one seems to care very much is an expression of a broad racial immiseration.
I want to talk about your framework that you develop in your book of the riot, and the strike and all of that. But before we get to that, tell us a little bit about what happens at a riot and whether what happens at a riot or with a riot is helpful for thinking and particularly whether thought is produced or sort of more precisely, sort of what does a riot produce?
That's a lot of question. The question of what happens at a riot, I think different people have different experiences. I can tell you a little bit about my experience at riots. And for me, one of the striking things that happens is a certain experience that one doesn't always know one's having, but one is having all the time, of being socially managed, socially disciplined, suddenly vanishes. One doesn't always walk down the street thinking, I'm obeying the law, I'm obeying the law, I'm obeying the law. But there's that moment in the riot where someone disobeys the law. They break a window. They throw a rock at a cop. They start looting something. And nothing happens. And someone else does it, and someone else does it, and you suddenly realize, oh, nothing's going to happen. The set of disciplines laid down by the state with the logic of capital and the force of state power, suddenly you realize, for sort of sheerly quantitative reasons, there's so many more of them, of you than there are of them, there's this qualitative shift that none of that discipline is in place. And it's like being in a car that suddenly loses its traction on the road and comes loose and it's skidding, except it's very exciting. It's not terrifying, it's sort of thrilling. That release from the 24-hour, 365-day social discipline. And it feels, I think, very liberatory, very emancipatory. And it does change the way participants think. And as to your question of whether thinking comes out of a riot, well, I have to say necessarily so. You know, I think all thinking comes out of lived experience. As we say, theory is immanent to struggle. And not just theory, thought in general, right? There's kinds of struggles, openly or implicitly political, that people go through. And new thinking tries to make an account of why that was powerful, why that keeps happening, why that's happening more, why people are committed to it, even if it doesn't seem self-evidently beneficial. So in that sense, inevitably, thinking comes out of it. Whether the sort of tradition of grand historical theorizing comes out of it, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You had said before that riot is often understood as an act of communication, and you have the famous Martin Luther King position.
Mm-hmm.
So start with that and reference Martin Luther King if you'd like.
Absolutely.
And tell us what you think of that.
So the trajectory of riot, if you think about it not as a few minutes or even as a few hours, but something that plays out over time, there's almost always a split in what we might call the community of riot. That sounds a little fancy. I'm not sure I love that term, but let's imagine there's a number of people who've participated in a riot or who feel committed to the riot or engaged with that experience, that moment of sort of potential emancipation and potential fighting back, and it persists. So if I think about what happened after Michael Brown was killed in Ferguson in the summer of 2014, that was an extremely sustained riot, an important moment in the trajectory of what we now call Black Lives Matter as a movement. And that was a really sustained riot event, and there was a classic split in it. And there's probably several ways to describe the split. Here's how I would describe it. On the one side, you have people, and maybe this is stronger at the beginning, who are committed to the riot as a practical activity. Let's say, actually fighting back against cops, destroying state power, actually looting stuff, which people often think is like a strange, terrible exception, but the long history of riot is looting from the get-go. It's the most traditional riot activity. So looting, destroying the power of the state, making your neighborhood inhospitable to people you don't want to be there, these various practical activities. And then there's the side that gets more committed to a kind of communicative track. who wants to generate support and engagement from people who are probably tuned in via various kinds of media, wants media support, wants a kind of sympathy, engages in a kind of respectability politics, turns toward more kinds of passive resistance and civil disobedience. They often take the Martin Luther King position, who has offered one of the famous statements that people often want to use to justify a riot, which is that the riot is the language of the unheard. And of course, this is a lovely sentiment in various ways. It's not paternalistic, it's not dismissive, it's not, oh, terrible disorder. So one wants to be sympathetic to King's position. But I also want to be a little bit hesitant or skeptical of it, because it does aggressively insist on the riot as a communication, as a kind of language, as needing to be legible, as needing to be heard, as trying to persuade. And I don't think that's the truth of the riot at all. And that position was very charismatic and successful in the 1950s, if you think about the civil rights movement, which had that split in it, right? We can describe that split as Malcolm X versus Martin Luther King. And so that split is already present there. And the King side, the communicative side that wants to win people over and bring people in, is very successful. But there's a reason it's successful. The reason it's successful, I think, is because it's able to win concessions from, at the moment, at that time, an incredibly wealthy U.S. state in the middle of the longest capitalist boom in the history of the planet. And it makes sense for the state to buy the social peace, to start supporting kinds of social programs, social housing, welfare, various programs, to expand them. And so the communicative side seems to win actual gains and concessions. And so, of course, they tend to triumph over the practical side, which is usually seen as a few overly militant, overly angry, sometimes outside agitators, participants. That's been less and less true, and that's the striking fact of our present. In a time in which the capacity of the state to purchase the social peace is deeply diminished, the side of communication and respectability is less able to win concessions. So people still feel the appeal and want to walk around in Ferguson with the famous slogan, "Hands up, don't shoot," which was supposedly Michael Brown's last words, or an indication of him being shot in cold blood. But of course, it's an indication of peacefulness, a supplication before the state. We have our hands up. And that side, as opposed to the side that actually wanted not to put their hands up but to fight back, it didn't actually get resolved as swiftly as it had in the past. The side I would call the practical side kept going for a long time and wasn't sort of easily dominated and overwhelmed by the communicative side, because everyone knows there's no concessions to be won. The era of carrots is over, and now it's just an era of sticks. The state has coercion on its side, and much less does it have its ability to sort of exercise soft power and draw people in. So I think we're seeing a real change in the dynamic.
Can you tell us a little why? Maybe you've written or thought about why the era of the communicative riot is struggling? And when you say that, just tell us the communicative riot is struggling because, and yeah. Or however you want to phrase it.
The communicative side of the split that happens during and after a riot, the understanding of the riot as a communicative act is struggling because the kinds of concessions it's meant to win, concessions from the government isn't able to offer in the way they used to. People, you know, there's still obviously corporations and individuals getting fantastically wealthy. People think that's the sign of a booming economy. It's not. Historically, in fact, as economies decline, you get greater and greater concentrations of wealth. So you get visible, extraordinary sort of, you know, piles of filthy lucre, but that doesn't mean at all the economy itself is booming. In general, I don't think the state has the deep pockets it once had to buy off the riot. And as a result, the communicative side, which wants to get bought off, that's always been its goal, is less persuasive. And so that sort of route for social energy or social antagonism to get channeled into after the period of open riot is now a little bit foreclosed and will be increasingly foreclosed over the next 5, 10, 20 years.
So is it then fair to say that when the primary form of the riot happened at the factory with the modes of production being there, now it's at the site of circulation, that circulation struggles will see more practical side of riots? Because is that something about their nature? Like, you know, in other words, if we're in this, and I kind of want you to talk a little bit about, if you feel up for it, a little bit about your framework of understanding where we're at right now with global capitalism, because I know you have a lot, that's like what you haven't mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think that's going to complete the pie here. If you know, sure, what I'm talking about.
No, I do completely. So to add to the sort of historical distinction between strike and riot, which previously I described as the difference between struggles over the price of labor and struggles over the price of market goods. So that also implies that the strike is going to be the dominant form when most people are involved in wage labor and notably industrial labor, where people share experiences and form cooperative relationships, which make the strike possible. And so the period of the strike, which in the West is probably the period from about, it's hard to say exactly, but maybe 1830 to 1975, is the period of expanding industrial capitalism. The riot, which is by far the dominant form before 1800, starts to come back with a vengeance in the 1960s and 1970s and overtakes the strike as the dominant form of social contest by the late 70s or the 80s. And this is exactly concomitant with the decline of industrial capitalism in the United States, in the Western world in general. The manufacturing profit rate sort of drops off the table around 1973. It shows its weaknesses in the 60s. And so two things happen, which are really the same thing at that time. One, capital itself shifts into circulation. Instead of investing all its money in factories, which are less and less profitable, it starts investing its money in strategies to circulate goods and services more quickly. So finance is an obvious example, and global shipping buildouts would be another. Ways, when the margin of profit is decreasing, to move more and more widgets through the system more and more quickly to try and maintain a magnitude of profit, to use the technical language. So capital shifts into circulation. But correspondingly, humans shift into circulation. A smaller and smaller percentage of the population is working in these scenes of industrial production. More and more people are working in circulation jobs, or even more significantly, not working at all. The category we call relative surplus population, people who've sort of been ejected from the formal economy, may still have to make their way. They, you know, do direct services that no one's employing them. They work for themselves, they sell drugs, they do sex work, they sell Lucy's on the corner, right? Eric Garner, who gets killed as part of the vast riot sequence in the 2014-15, is selling individual cigarettes on the street corner. A classic example of someone who's been ejected from the wage economy and is trying to make their way in the sphere of circulation out in the market. So capital shifts into circulation, humans shift into circulation as circulation workers or a surplus population. And so struggles happen there. And the sphere of circulation is the sphere not of the wage, but of how you're going to make your way in the world outside the wage. So the riot, which is exactly that, right? The riot is a struggle over how to survive, not via the wage, but via the price of market goods, really takes off then and increases and will keep increasing.
And pauses for one second.
Yes.
Speaking of the state, we got the man going by outside. So it's just good.
Ideological state apparatus.
Take a break and get some water.
How much do we need to backtrack?
I don't think we need to backtrack.
Not too much.
We just pick up from where we were.
We can pick up from Eric Gardner and surplus populations. Thank you for that connection.
Exactly.
Yeah, it does. It does add. And I love, there's all these noises we hear now when it's silent with the birds and everything.
Hey, how are you?
Hi.
Thanks for letting us use this space. We really appreciate it.
Hi there.
Welcome. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Are you holding an LP in your hand? Are you holding, is that an actual record album cover?
No, this is, a friend of mine just gave this to me.
Oh,
this is from 1940.
Oh, nice, look at that.
Some quite fanciful art around naval.
What do you know?
Wow.
He has a fascination for that.
Good deal.
Our office is on 11th Street, right up 11th Street from the Washington Navy Yard.
Oh, gotcha.
Michael claims to have the second best cutlass collection on 11th Street.
This is an example of weaving those in as you can. Very nice. But this is excellent. And just as a heads up, we want to go back to, we're on a very good little tangent here. I want to go a little bit more on your framework and how it fits into the history. I think we've almost completed this pie with the talk about capital. But, who's this? Wallerstein. You know, is Wallerstein still living?
Yeah.
I love him. You know, he has his formulations down if you listen to him talk like you do. He's a very, it's almost too cogent for theoretical people.
It's really amazing.
Do you know what I mean?
No, it's interesting. You know what I mean? So he's written those, I mean, he's done the exact thing.
Let us know when you're ready, bro.
He's written
you're ready.
The World Systems Analysis book three times. Like first the 900-page version, and then the 400-page version, and then the 160-page version. Like he just gets like clearer
now
and
now it's
going to
be like a PowerPoint pretty soon.
I know, right? You know? And so now I just have like a short one I assign to my students.
Yeah, it's so good. Okay, so surplus populations, why don't you pick up at capital goes into circulation and humans do, and tell us the Gardner example of how that fits in one more time.
So there's a double shift that happens. It's really a single phenomenon, but it has two sides, the side of capital and the side of humans. So as industrial production wanes, its profitability falls off a table around 1973. Capital itself so there's a single phenomenon with two sides, which we could describe as a vast restructuring of the economic system at a global level. And the two sides are the motion of capital and the motion of humans and their lives. As industrial profitability collapses around 1973 or so, capital shifts into circulation in an attempt to stay alive. It's making less money per widget, and so the logic is we'll pump more and more widgets through the system faster and faster, more and more services exchange faster and faster. We might think of the build-out both of the financial network and the shipping network as two aspects of this shift to circulation and to increasing turnover. At the same time, as capital leaps into circulation, inevitably, humans leap or are pushed into circulation. And there's two senses of this, at least. One is more and more have jobs in circulation. FedEx, for example, is born in 1973, and this is no coincidence. More and more kinds of labor tasks happen, circulating commodities rather than making them and producing surplus value in that way. But at the same time, there's a greater and greater production of what we call relative surplus population, which is people who've been ejected from the wage entirely, usually by increases in productivity, so you can still make a huge number of cars with an assembly line, but you didn't need that many people to run it. And so they're sort of ejected from the wage, and they have to make their way in the world without access to the formal wage. And so because there's not much of a social safety net anymore, they have to do various kinds of jobs sort of on the fringes of the market, right? So selling drugs, sex work, opening up a shoe shine stand on the corner, selling Lucy's. That's Eric Garner in New York, right, who gets killed by the cops as part of the sequence of building racialized riots in 2014, 2015. And he's someone who's been ejected from the wage, right? And he's trying to make his way in the world selling individual cigarettes on the street corner when he has a run-in with the cops and they choke him to death. So that's an example of this sort of kind of person who's more and more been pushed out of industrial production, so out of the logic of the strike, and into circulation, into the space of the market, having to figure out how to make their way there rather than through the wage. And so inevitably you see struggles that don't have to do with the wage, but do have to do with surviving beyond it. And that's what the riot is. That's all the riot is. And because that shift to surplus population is always racialized, it's always people of color who get pushed into that space first in the United States, also in England and France as well. In some sense, it can be no surprise that the riot even if at one level it's about surplus population and shifts in global capital, is also about race and racialization. So we can see those things coming together in a figure like Eric Garner, a figure like Michael Brown, many other examples, which give us a unity of the idea of the price riot and the race riot.
Excellent, excellent. So on this next question, I'd like for you to, let's do it maybe a couple times and try to be a little pithy, a little soundbitey, if you like. And the question is our age an age of insurrections and why? And start this question sort of as if we haven't heard everything else you said, because this is a film, so everything's very choppable and choppy insofar as what we pull from. So sort of, it's always frustrating for actors, like if you're a theater actor, you go do a film and it's like, oh, wait a second, I have to play this scene at the very end. So it's sort of, but think about it as you're answering that, just that question. We haven't heard anything else you said. Is our age an age of insurrections and why?
Our age is an age of riots, there's no doubt about it. That comes from a restructuring of global capital and global class recomposition and modes of racialization. And there's more, going to be more riots, and I guarantee you that. Whether that means we're an age of resurrections is a bit of an open question. It leaves us with an attempt to think about whether riots are insurrections, whether they lead to insurrections. And one thing we could hope is, if there's more and more riots, eventually they're going to meet each other in the street, at the border of two towns, on a freeway. At that point, I think it'll be inarguable that we're looking at insurrections and that they can keep growing.
Let's do that again. That was nice. Let's do that one more time. Because that was so good. Tight little formulation, so please.
So there's no doubt that we live in an age of riots. The global restructuring of capital, the global class recomposition, we've already seen this increase in riots, and that's going to keep going, and that's, I think, something we can be sure of. The question of whether those riots will become what even the skeptical would agree are insurrections is open, but I think it's quite likely. One riot is bound to meet the next as we see more and more of them. Two riots, three riots, 100 riots, and at some point it's going to be inarguable that these are of great political substance. There will be something that starts to look more like the organization that some people feel is lacking, and I think no one's going to deny that's insurrection when that happens.
Very nice. Jesse?
I think it's fantastic.
Okay, good.
Yeah,
sweet.
That's exactly what we're doing.
All right, good. Good, good, good. Yes, I agree. Okay.
I do have a couple other additions, but I figured I'd wait till the end to let you get through everything you want to do with the discussion. And
well, I think that one we talked about can come up as an abridgment to my next question.
Sure.
My next question is, and I'm using the term philosopher. We could probably also substitute that with theorist. Mm-hmm. So whatever you feel more comfortable with.
Don't care.
Does the insurrection need the philosopher? I'm just going to say there's three parts here, mm-hmm. so we can do one at a time if you wish. Or does the philosopher need the insurrection? Is there a role for philosophy to play in insurrections?
Sorry, I need
I can
three.
Repeat those. Yeah. So the question is, we've interviewed a lot of academic philosophers. You're not an academic philosopher by training, but you dibble-dabble in that world. So again, maybe you want, what do you want to use, thinker? Do you want to use theorist? How do you want to phrase that?
Theorist.
Okay, theorist. Okay, good. Maybe you could say it like the theorist or the person who thinks for a living, or who's a thinker, whatever, however you want to say it. Why should they be drawn to an insurrection? And why should they care about an insurrection? And is there a relationship of dependency or a relationship of necessity between this phenomenon of the riot insurrection and this thing over here called the work of thinking?
So that's a great set of questions. I could give you a super complicated theoretical answer.
And remember to repeat it when you answer it.
So that's a super great question about the relationship between the riot and the theorist, what are the vectors by which they might need each other, the significance of the theorist in relation to the riot. And I think there's like super complicated answers that will be ironically theoretical, and we could talk about the fate of the university and how that's linked to transformations in global capital that also structure the rise of riots. But let me give a little bit more practical answer if I can. I don't think that insurrections need theorists, but I think need might be the wrong word. Theorists enter into what is, if they're serious about what they do, they enter into what's significant and what's open and what leaves room for trying to puzzle through the problems of the moment. And more we're going to have theorists who might have dismissed riots in the past engaging with them, and that's the truth of the riot, not the truth of theory. So I don't know if they need each other, but it seems to me certain that they will know each other more and more. And I think that's going to be quite interesting. The reason I think we're talking about theorists and not philosophers, if we use a sort of classic distinction, is that for a long time philosophers sort of told us what we should do and sort of what the good life was and what the right ideas were and what the proper questions were. And I think in wanting to believe in theorists, which on some days I do, they're not so interested in providing those normative models. They're more interested in entering into the particulars and struggles of the present and trying to feel what possibilities are imminent within them. In that sense, the riot is extremely seductive, I think, for a lot of thinkers.
Hey guys.
Yes.
I need to change the
very
batteries
nice.
In your wireless.
Sure.
That's okay. Just grab that pack.
So, what's that?
I'm just going to see if he can find a couple more.
So, I think this is a bigger place for your question on experts in all of this
sure.
business. Yeah.
Do we need to redo that? Did we get that one, or did that die?
We got it. I've got a backup mic on all of this.
We got that one over here.
Okay.
I don't think we need to do that again. I think that's good. Okay. I think that's good. I think. I guess your model is. You know, I'll put it this way: we've interviewed a couple of people who call themselves Marxist thinkers, philosophers, whatever, who have a lot of kind of flowery things to say about meaning of riots and insurrections and how they have this kind of like great contribution to thinking. And I think in your model, yours is not, so to speak, a kind of meaning is accessible in the riot, right? In the same way that communication's not quite, is foreclosed. If meaning is also foreclosed, and maybe we could talk about that, then thought becomes a negative operation. So it's kind of thought that, I mean, is it a dialectical sort of thing, or is the riot almost, one could say, of a different category where it's non-dialectizable? It's actually a collapse. It's the real itself. It's like, you know, something like.
No, I don't buy that absolute immediacy sort of claim of the riot. But I don't think that the other absolute immediacy is deducing a meaning that's not a practical political meaning of struggle, right? So, like, I do think it's deeply dialectical, but I don't think the dialectic is between. So, I mean, to back up a second.
We're probably not going to use that
right,
in
no,
the film
I'll,
yet.
I'll give you here's my big ticket intellectual claim.
Sure.
The materialist dialectic is not a dialectic of materialism and idealism. And
right.
over and over again, people
right.
want to produce it as that. Like,
right.
oh, so my idealism
right.
Is part of the dialectic. I just don't think that's true. I don't
right.
think that's what materialist dialectic is. I think a materialist dialectic is a struggle between classes and between use value and exchange value. Like
I
those
see.
Are the dialectical objects.
Well, for Baijiu, it's a
Baijiu's not a dialectical thinker.
No, but
Dan
it's
Daniel.
A double split within idealism.
Hmm?
He splits idealism itself.
I know.
He says anyone who calls themselves a materialist dialectician today is actually an idealist, and they need to be split again. So it's a bit of a, this is his logics of worlds continuation
yeah.
of that.
I'm aware. I'm familiar. I don't buy it.
Maybe over a beer we can discuss this at another time. But I don't think our film will be able to have the bandwidth to bring in Hegel and dialectics. And that's okay.
That's all right.
The masses will produce it on their own, and they don't even need to read the logic. But yeah, I mean, yeah, it's interesting though. This is. Are you good, by the way?
Yeah.
You're good. Oh, okay, okay, okay. I'm done.
Yeah, sorry.
All right. So Jesse, why don't you formulate the question as a sort of piggyback from where we were talking about, like,
which one?
Your question on
the one that I've added in there.
Yes.
Okay. Sure.
I think it's a good time for it.
Sure. Yeah. So, I'm coming not from a philosophical background or a theoretical background.
Excellent.
So, you know, forgive me if these questions are...
They're going to be good already.
Okay, I hope so. So one of the things that we've been running into is this idea of academic thinkers and thinkers who, you know, base their training or their, you know, their philosophies, their frameworks on what's learned in the streets, you know, to use that phrase, or in a riot or in an insurrection. Do you see any kind of conflict between those two? I mean, is there
between
the idea of classically trained thinkers, theorists, and people who, you know, maybe coming up with frameworks of insurrection
yeah.
on their own?
Remembering also that our characters, and you helped us identify some potential characters, mm-hmm. will be, this is like part one of our film.
Mm-hmm.
Part two of our film is to sort of go
actors.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And ideally, how do they relate to thinkers?
Yeah.
Right.
So we want more about this, because this is a very important part of the film.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I guess when I say conflict, just to fill it out a little bit more, I mean, it could be a conflict that comes out in, you know, conferences or you know, talks, or it could be actual intellectual conflict between the content of the ideas themselves, or just, I'm just curious, because I just don't know, mm-hmm. not having sort of been on the front lines there.
So that's an amazing question that like deserves an entire movie. And the funny thing is, I know some of my friends would give you a very clear answer, which would be like, fuck academics, get them out of the way. They have no business being in the streets or even really talking about it.
And sorry
to look over there.
Yeah. Keep here and rephrase it without, as if you're talking to one of us.
Without, as if I'm talking to one of
you? Obviously, you're talking to us, but you're not like... don't make it clear that you're answering our questions.
You don't need to refer to the question.
So the question about academic thinkers who have become engaged with the question of riots and those who identify themselves as you know, street fighters, participants, as being part of it, some of them I know, some friends of mine, are very hostile to the idea that academics should take an interest in these things, think that they have no business being there, think that it's a bourgeois luxury. I don't want to take that position. At the same time, I think it's clear enough to see that there's a certain amount of tension between there being, you know, conferences on the communist horizon at Birkbeck, while there's a riot happening in Tottenham, you know, a couple of miles away. And moreover, the people who sometimes get called conference communists sort of holding opinions about riots that are often a bit paternalistic or even dismissive. They refer to them as, oh, shopping on steroids, as needing someone to lead them and give them direction. And given these things, I can understand why there's an antipathy between participants in a riot and professional thinkers. At the same time, I think it's also the case that one of the things the riot does want to overcome, because for me it's a deeply dialectical motion, it's part of a larger dialectical motion, it wants to overcome that antinomy between those who act and those who think. Not through some magical perfect immediacy, but neither through some reflective distance, but the idea that even if you have thought for a living in your life, or even if you're interested in it from an intellectual perspective, that within the riot, you might actually be a participant in the riot in the morning and theorize it about it at night. And that's the dream, right? Not to abolish either one, but for all those positions to be inhabitable for everyone. So instead of having a class of professional thinkers and a class of people who are getting tear gassed, you have an insurrectionary population for which those activities and others are open to all. And that's, I think, really part of the dream of the riot.
Has there ever been an insurrectionary population in history?
Without a doubt.
Okay, tell us just and repeat that, because that, I mean, that's just sort of...
Let me think for a second.
Yeah, I'm thinking like Paris Commune, something, yeah. That's an interesting idea. But I mean, you say insurrectionary population. You bring up scale, to what extent, you know, how far flung, you know, transcended class in a way or something like that. That's interesting.
I think there have been insurrectionary populations. Again, I don't think we want to spend hours of our lives defining these terms. So at one level, you might say, well, the Paris Commune was an insurrectionary population from before it started, right? From the moment when they're trying to bring order to an unruly town, in early March in 1871, through the 72 days of the Commune. You could think of that as an insurrectionary population. But I also think that there's ways in which the people living in a radically deindustrialized Detroit, confronting the fact that life just can't go on like this forever, also might be thought of as an insurrectionary population. I think that people who have been living in countries where there's an extraordinary open repression all the time that can't last might be thought of as insurrectionary populations. As to whether those people, their daily lives open up into theorizing the insurrection or engaging in practical activities around the insurrection, often we don't know until later, and discover not just that there were emancipatory fighters living in that neighborhood the whole time, but that there were great thinkers who lived in the neighborhood the whole time, and perhaps they were the same people. And I think there have been populations like that in places around the world for centuries, and I think we have them now, and I think we're maybe starting to see them more and more.
Wow. Jesse, we had talked in earlier interviews with our scholars about the international connection of like movement of squares to anti-austerity, to Occupy, and like the, you know, the whole train that started from Tahrir out. What do you think about people that think like that? Like Bifo thinks like this.
Thinks what about?
They think that there's a relationality. I'm just curious.
I'll fucking kill this question.
Okay, no, the good, yeah. good. Yeah. And please reference, because we're now getting to my next question, which is, what do you think about people that theorize the return of the riot today, and what's wrong with that? So that's kind of the larger question, but if you could start here, or what's good about it, and like the whole kind of take a survey of that field.
Okay, so as to whether there's a connection between what seems like a wave that's moving around the globe and it sort of rises here, rises there, we can think about Tahrir Square, the movement of the squares, the movement of the plazas, largely in Europe, the Occupy movement in the U.S., Euromaidan, various things like this. For me, it fits clearly within a political economic framework. Like there's attempts to theorize its subjectivity. They probably start with Agamben's account of the people in Tiananmen Square in 1989, what he calls the whatever singularity of people who are brought together without any unifying sort of positionality, right? They're just brought together by a shared no or something like that. But for me, I'd want to move it out of a philosophical register and note again that what they share is exactly their exclusion, an increasing exclusion from a wage and a living wage and from the heart of the economy. And so as you get this rise in people pushed out of the labor force, pushed out of jobs that are adequate to survive, inevitably they gather, and inevitably they don't gather in the workplace because that's exactly where they've been expelled from, and they're left with the public square, right? The agora, which has those two historical meanings of the market, that is to say not the factory, right, but the market, and the place of public speaking. And the logic of public speaking and the logic of the market, that's always where the riot has been. You go back to 1347, which is where my book starts, with two riots that happen in England where they're stopping grain from being shipped away to soldiers because they're hungry. And the riot has always begun in the square and the port. And so that it returns to the square and sometimes the port, as in Oakland in 2011, and other places as well, shouldn't surprise us at all, nor should we exaggerate some brand new historical phenomenon. It's actually a great historical tradition and trajectory. The logic by which we return to it is fairly clear, from an era of circulation to an era of production, back to an era of circulation. So it makes a lot of sense. It clearly has a unity. It clearly has to do with the restructuring of the global political economy. And I always want to read it that way, right? I want to look at the actual situation, understand what it is, and why it affords certain possibilities and not others. I have no interest in deducing a should, in thinking about what the right thing to do is that people ought to be doing. I just want to understand the world before me.
So you said something that people think that there's a new subjectivity. Without using the word subjectivity or describing what that means, why do you disagree with that again? Why is that not what's happening with these riots from 2010 till now? Remember to repeat that.
I think to understand their commonality, there's probably a couple of ways to understand it. One is that people see tactics and strategies being tried in other places, and they sort of adapt them for their own circumstances. So maybe Oscar Grant Plaza in Oakland looks a bit like Tahrir Square in the sense that it's the sort of central political stage and in the public space. So there's that form of imitation and repetition, but there's also the underlying materialist logic of people being pushed into the space of the plaza, the space of the market. And so to explain this via a shared subjectivity seems to me to be an error to believe there's some mode of consciousness that leads to this. Now, whether a mode of consciousness arises from this, sure, probably. I don't think we have a clear picture of that yet. I always want to be as slow as possible to move to explaining things via consciousness, a set of beliefs, a set of ideological commitments. I tend to think that those things arise from real conditions and are less powerful for explaining real conditions.
What is consciousness? Is that different than thought? So if like the riot has the potential to produce consciousness, is that the same thing as saying it has the potential to produce thought? I'm just curious what, because it's the first time you've said that.
I think when I distinguish between thought and consciousness, it's probably a convenience. I think by thought, I'm trying to suggest theorizations, attempts to understand the phenomenon of the riot, the phenomenon of insurrections. Whereas the idea of a shared consciousness among participants is if, oh, they all have the same commitment or the same description of their own lives in the present and why they're doing what they're doing. You know, I spent a lot of time, like I imagine a lot of us did, in an Occupy encampment in Occupy Oakland, and I came to know a lot of people there. And what was striking was their incoherence. They thought wildly different things. And their situations were wildly different. In the simplest sketch, there were two significant categories. And one was involved people who were more or less downwardly mobile. People you'd probably say middle class, not a category I love, but sort of middle class people who the idea that they would be increasingly integrated into a life of upward mobility that had been the promise of the US century was now clearly foreclosed. Their lives were getting worse and worse. And they experienced that as a real tumble and a real threat, and that brought them out. And that's one category. And there's another category, which is below the lower class, right? This category of surplus population. They maybe have no place to live or not much of a place to live, and that's what brings them to the square. And so we might think of the Occupy movement in the US as an attempt at a class compact between a waning or declining middle class and a lumpen proletarian or new proletarian class. And it didn't quite happen. Or it didn't happen. There actually wasn't enough of a shared experience for those people really to say, oh, we are the same. Let's proceed together. Let's figure out what to do next. In fact, there was so much difference and so much struggle and disagreement and mistrust among those groups that that was the internal limit, not as powerful as the external limit, which was the police and the vast deployment of state power across the nation, which is a much more powerful limit. But this internal limit, the fact this new class collectivity was not quite possible, is a measure for me that there is no new shared consciousness that people have. But we might be getting there, right? The next time this happens, the declining middle class and the new proletariat are going to be much closer together in their real situations, and with much less of a hope on one side that they might still get something from engaging cheerfully with the world as it is. Of course, only one side has that hope. The other side has no such delusions. But the next time it happens, in general, we'll see fewer delusions about that and a much larger chance at a ability to move forward in a collective way. But that won't be because people arrived at a thought or an idea. It'll be because their situations made holding out the hope of integrating themselves into capitalist late modernity have been foreclosed. That's just not possible, and the consciousness will flow from that.
Is that a global phenomenon, a global tension, or is this?
In different ways, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so let's talk about that, and let's talk about, because this ties into, with most things, people want to know, what do you define it as success, what is a failure? And so looking in the future of riots, is something like a success, a production of a unity between these two, or what you say, a compact?
Yeah.
I'm just curious, and so start with the global and then kind of move to that a little bit more, because that's a really nice point.
So I think this scission between a downwardly mobile class that previously had been happily integrated into capital and a class that is entirely excluded exists at a global scale. I don't think we want to translate it too easily to talk about the middle class in Ghana is a quite mysterious operation and importing of terms. And so I don't want to be too casual. But I think the idea that those have historically been different struggles between the excluded of capital and the threatened of capital or the exploited of capital, the historically have been different struggles and are increasingly becoming a unified struggle at a global level. And that unity will not be the success of the insurrection. That unity will happen because of the success of the insurrection. The insurrections will keep happening, they'll keep growing, and the more that they're able to stop being recuperated as parts of struggle to make mild reforms, but become openly antagonistic to state and capital as they exist, those will be the successes. And the more those happen, and the more people see that's a possibility, and the more people are pushed toward that struggle because there's no chance of succeeding with a mild reformist struggle, the more we'll see those disparate groups coming together into unity.
Well, this is new. I mean, we didn't talk about this before.
Oh, we should talk about the double riot. Ask me, what about the double riot?
What about the double riot? What about the double riot? How are you doing over there? You good? It's cold in here. Are you freezing?
I'm doing okay. I'm doing
you're
okay.
Good? You're good?
I'm doing okay.
I'm okay.
Yeah.
Good. Your toes still have circulation?
They're great.
They don't need to like riot down there in the
circulation. I'm having a little shoe riot, but it's okay. It's fine.
Okay, the double riot.
The double riot is something I've been trying to understand. But I've really been noticing it more and more as I've been doing my research. So to take an early case, let's talk about the two riots in Chicago in 1968. So there's a race riot, in quotation marks, which happens along with others across the nation after the killing of Martin Luther King early in 1968. And then there's the National Convention riot that also happened. So two different riots, one marked black, one marked white, although neither of them is racially purely homogenous. But one is marked black and one is marked white. But two different riots. Now I want to note some things. Let's leap forward to our current century, where in France, first you get the banlieue riots, which are racialized, right? North African and Arabic riots. And the next year you get the so-called CPE riots, which are mostly marked as being students and marked as white. In adjacent years, two riots, one racially marked, one coded as white. Let's go to England, where in 2010 you get massive student rioting, smashing of buildings, lots of occupations. 2011, the Tottenham riots, racially marked as people of color. Let's go to Oakland, where you get the exact same thing. 2009, the Oscar Grant riots, after he's killed, classic cycle of a black kid gets killed by cops, and then there's racialized rioting. And then the same year, in the same, this is killing
yeah,
me.
Yeah. It's so appropriate, too. It's so hilarious.
And so let's go to the Bay Area in 2009, which begins with Oscar Grant, a black kid getting killed by the cops. You get racialized rioting. Later in that year, on the campuses of the University of California, other campuses, you get students coded white, although not exclusively so, occupying buildings, blockades, riots. Again, over and over again, you get this pattern of the double riot, one coded as non-white and one coded as white, with Chicago as sort of the example. Now, I'm not quite sure what to make of this, except it's striking historically, and it's another example of these two different kinds of riots, one of the utterly excluded and one of those with a foreclosed future, who thought they had a future, but it turns out they don't. And those riots are getting closer and closer together, temporally, geographically. I think we have to believe there will eventually be one riot, and that's the insurrection.
We're done. Booyah. We're done. Actually, we can take a little bit of a break if you want. Because we've been on a roll.
Using a restroom.
Yeah, I'm gonna take a little bit of a break.
Yeah, let's take a little break. Okay. Historically, they enter into a booming industrial sector. When they get expelled from that, they move into the service sector. And when there's no space in any of those, they become surplus population. Now, because there's no more real possibility for industrial growth, because productivity is so high, you know, you can make all the cars you need with very few workers.
Yeah.
Now, in so-called less developed places where people are getting kicked out of agriculture, they can't go into industry, so they go into services. This is even true in China currently. Everyone thinks of China as the new workshop of the world. In China, the industrial sector for labor has been declining over the last few years, and it's actually service that's been growing and absorbing this post-peasantry that's been kicked out of agricultural work by, you know, by the reforms that come in 1978 and industrial transformations that make it more effective to growth. So they get kicked out of jobs in agriculture, they get absorbed by service, or they don't get absorbed at all. And so they enter into surplus population. So for me, those are the possibilities, right? Peasant and agriculture, industrial labor, service sector, and surplus population, lumpen. And Fanon sees quite early in 62 that there's not going to be this great absorption into some new wage sector, and that these lumpen who have come from the countryside in hopes of jobs in the city are not going to find them, are not going to find permanent stable work. And you sort of start to get these rings of surplus population around cities, which are true to this day. If you look at Mike Davis's book, Planet of Slums, right, it's all about these cities across the globe, especially in the global south, with 1 million, 2 million, 6 million people living in circles around these urban centers, trying to figure out ways to survive outside the formal economy. And these are need to be understood as the proletariat rather than just thinking of traditional industrial labor as the proletariat. You know, the word historically means without reserves. And that's who we're talking about. People who have no reserves, they have no real integration into the economy, and who I think will be the insurrectionary class. And Fanon sees this in 1962, so he's been a very important thinker for me.
I want to return to something you said, that theory is imminent to struggle. And we just want to roll with this idea because it's central, I think, idea of our film. If theory is imminent to struggle, then talk a little bit about how that might be shared out to people that are not necessarily participating in the riot. Going back to kind of like, so theory is imminent to struggle, like then who are the actors that are undergoing this experience of theory? And so to sort of want to return to this question a little bit, because we like this formulation of theory being imminent to struggle. How would you say that is shared?
I'm not sure I understand what your question is, to be honest.
So, okay. The insurrection is a site where theory is produced. You agree.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. How then does it get disseminated out? How then does, maybe you could use like an example of like you said, for example, in Oakland, there was these people from these two classes and they had wildly different ideas and accounts of their own experience and why they were there. Mm-hmm. And there's something that they were seized by, thought, theory, and so on.
I think. Can I interject real quick?
Please, go ahead.
I think one of the reasons you might be getting stuck up. This is a question from me, so it's sort of on a different. It's on a lower level than some of the discussions we've been having.
It's on a higher level. You're actually exactly backwards. It's too abstract for me.
I confess.
The idea just being like, I think for folks that are coming into this from the outside, just the idea of of that concept of theory is imminent to struggle.
Yeah.
Like, what does that mean? Who are the people who are coming up with these theories? And,
yeah, there you go. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There's lots of people who come up with. So I'm sorry. Let me backtrack.
Yeah.
So when I say theory is imminent to struggle, and I don't want to take credit for that formulation, I take that to be sort of a tenet of historical materialism. To be honest, there's lots of different people who enter into what we might call theoretical ways of understanding or approaching, and some of them are from the professional theorizing class, get interested in these phenomena, maybe immerse themselves in the experience of riot or insurrection and do their theorizing. There's also, Gramsci had this category of the organic intellectual, and I've certainly seen various examples of that. I have a good friend, he doesn't like to have his name used, so I'm not going to, but he's in no way a theorist. He doesn't have the kind of formal education that any theorists I know do, but has done, I think, the most interesting and sophisticated writing about the riots in Baltimore, which is where he's originally from. He now lives in the Bay Area, but he hurried back to Baltimore when the riots were happening there in 2015, went back to where he'd grown up, and has tried to write about it. He doesn't try to publish it. He's shared it with friends, and I think it's profound. I think it's insightful. But what I don't want to do is give the idea that, like, well, so there's a riot or an insurrection, then there's theory, then someone else reads the theory somewhere else, and then they have a riot. That's not a mode of transmission that I believe happens. Again, I'm going to insist over and over again, riots happen because of conditions that precede theory. And they'll keep on throwing off theory, but they're going to keep on happening whether there's theory or not. They don't require theory as fuel for their fire. It's those who might be interested in sort of having a predictive account of what we might be expected to see in the future and how one might want to orient themselves to that. But we don't all get to choose. In some sense, choosing your orientation is a bit of a luxury too. Most of the people who find themselves caught up in riots, either excitedly, unhappily, anxiously, haven't made that choice strategically to be in a riot that day. And I don't want to produce a world picture where riots happen because someone provided a theory for them.
Thank you. That's a great answer.
Excellent. I agree. Want to revisit communicative versus practical a little bit, because I really think this is a conflict, and I think you've brought up two important conflicts that we seem to be facing with the future of insurrections and the current landscape of insurrections, which is first this break between agents with that are practical versus communicative, and then the other one being these two populations that try to seek a sort of compact.
Yeah.
So my specific question is, if communicative riots are sort of failing today,
you keep on saying communicative riots. I don't think there's, like, in the riot, there's a split between a side that's communicative.
Yeah.
There's no communicative riot.
So if the people that are seeking to make the riot communicative, or to harness the communicative aspects of riot, you would think that the philosopher would be the one who may in some cases be wanting to sort of formalize that and to say, yes, like we may have the means available to formalize this and sort of better communicate it.
Mm-hmm.
But if they're not working out, if that's not working, then that creates a certain conflict for people. And so how would you, like, advise them? What would you say? Like, if so many people come to the streets and or look at the news footage of the streets and what's happening, and we know that their natural take is going to be on that side, like, can you say a little bit more about where might they go if they can't speak the language of the unheard? If that language is not able to be effective, then what does that leave for people to do?
For thinkers to do. Who's your people?
Maybe
in that
not
sentence?
Just thinkers, but I feel like it's more than just thinkers. I'm just saying that it seems to me that thinkers would be maybe perhaps in that direction. I guess I'm just saying that it seems much more of a difficult proposal for people to understand their place and to participate, to be a participant in the horizon of possible riots in the future, given that this strategy of communication is defective. So I think what you need to revisit that and kind of talk a little bit more about that.
I can, but you won't like my answer. So, I think it's certainly the case that in this split I've tried to describe within the riot and within the community of riot, between those who imagine it as a practical activity and those who imagine it as a communicative activity. I'm going to start that again. So, if it's indeed the case that within the riot and following the riot, there's a split between a community that sees it as a practical activity and a community that sees it as a communicative activity, one thing I'll say is it's that latter side, the communicative side, which is inevitably going to be more appealing for people who think and communicate for a living. So intellectuals, academics, scholars, theorists are of course going to be drawn to that communicative model and want to help with it and want to give it a coherence and give it a rationale and give it an eloquence. And I think that's not to be trusted. I think that's people searching for their car keys under the streetlights. It's like it's the thing they know how to do, where they sort of the possible categories are predetermined for them and they go that way. But as I hope to suggest, that split, the communicative side, simply has less and less of an opportunity for success. Because the things it can successfully demand as a passive polity are less and less on the table. And the kind of horizon of reform diminishes increasingly. So it's true that the foreclosure of that is going to seem like more and more of a problem for people. But when we say that, I want to be really clear about who people are. We're talking about what in the end is a fairly narrow class of people for whom passive politics and discursive activity feel fundamentally more appealing and like a way in. And it's true that for that class of people, this transformation in the riot is going to present difficulties, and they're not going to be sure how they figure in, and they're going to feel more and more alienated from the riot, and indeed they're going to be inclined more and more to dismiss the riot as pure disorder, as not having a rationale, as not being adequately organized, as being politically insubstantial. I'm not worried too much about that class of people because I think they're going to find themselves increasingly in a minority. I think the people who are compelled to take part in practical activities to stay alive and to make their way in the world and to figure out how to reproduce themselves and their communities outside of capital, that group is growing. And the necessities of that are growing. And I think that that trajectory, as it grows and takes on force and takes on not just evident immiseration, but evident momentum, will actually become more and more accessible to the thinking classes who are, might be more inclined toward communicative engagement, will recognize that that's has a historical moment that is passing or is past, and that thinking too might want to get in line with the practical procedures of riot and figure out what it can do in relation to that. And that'll be a dialectical movement. That's the one you want, is when thinking races to catch up with the necessity of practice. And that moment, I think, will be exciting for a lot of people.
I'm very glad we revisited that. Right, because you know the audience of this film will be of that.
I know.
okay. All right. We got that out of our system. We're good. We're good. Okay. So we want to talk about political organization. I have two questions left.
Okay.
Political organization. Jody Dean. Jody Dean's in the film, prominently in the film. And without sort of naming her, maybe you could discuss a little bit about some of the problems that you have with these formulations of political, because you know it's maybe true that that diminishing class you just talked about is also the political organization phenomenon is part of there. So dovetails nicely here.
So when people talk about political organization, I always get a little bit confused and try and get them to tell me a little bit more about what they mean. Oftentimes, it turns out they mean lessons learned from the Soviet revolutionary sequence from 1905 to 1917 or so. And for them, that's what organization is. It's what we used to call the mass class party sequence. It's a particular kind of revolutionary unfolding that people really recognize, which is not possible in the present. So I'm always a bit puzzled when they say, well, look, we need to organize in this way, and I see it as a kind of live-action role-playing of a century past, which is simply not possible. There is no industrial class fraction that can stand as a whole for the proletariat and organize itself into a party that can seize the state and seize the means of production. That's just not happening. So that's one sense of organization that I think is foreclosed, and I don't understand why people are attached to it. In some other sense, they mean, well, riots just seem like chaos. They seem like a great disorder, and how can you valorize that and say people should do that when we're clearly going to need some kind of organization if we want to win a revolutionary struggle? And there they mean it in a more practical sense. And I have no doubt that we're going to see a lot of organization like that. If organization is people agreeing together to do this thing and not that thing, and do it in this way and not that way, it already happens in riots. And the idea that it doesn't happen in riots is a misrecognition. I think it's kind of a racist misrecognition often. Robin D.G. Kelly writes very eloquently about the kinds of organization that were happening in Watts in the early 60s before the 65 riots, which made that uprising possible. the kinds of organization that were happening in Detroit that made the Great Rebellion of 68 possible. So I think that there's more organization there in the practical sense, not in the LARPing 1917 sense, but in the practical sense, I think there's more than people might recognize, and I think there increasingly will be more. I think when people can say, let's loot that building, they can also say, let's seize that state house. And that's going to be a question of balance of forces. It's not going to be a question of whether there's been a strong labor union on the scene passing out papers and getting people together. It's not going to be a question of whether there's a vanguard party that's telling people what to do. So there will be organization. There is organization. I'm just very leery of having this sort of template of organization that in an uninspected way is borrowed from a past that's no longer with us.
I think your stuff before describing circulation and how humans fit into circulation adequately tells us as to why that's not possible.
Yeah.
So we don't have to revisit that. Okay, so I want to talk about the future, even though we've touched on the future a little bit. Why don't you give us something, maybe we can do this a couple times, just a little bit about what we can expect in the future. We've talked about this very nice idea of insurrectionary population and so on, but tell us what can we expect in the future when it comes to riots, and what type will they be, based on your model? Because I know you've talked a lot about street blockades and all that fun stuff which people are doing already. And when you make that those points, reference to specific things that people know, like names would be good, including Black Lives Matter. Because that's going to be, I think, a big focus too. Right.
So I want to be leery of making too many predictions. I'm used to being wrong, but I don't love it. I think that, you know, step one, we're going to see more and more riots. Step two, they're more and more going to follow the logic of circulation. Now, circulation is actually quite a capacious phrase. It refers to, you know, a vast sphere of capital, but it also refers specifically to the motion of bodies and goods through space. So, for example, in 2014, when Darren Wilson, the murderer of Michael Brown, was not indicted, and we saw riots across the U.S. In more than 20 cities, and they without fail took the same form. People went out and they blocked a freeway, and if a freeway wasn't available, they blocked a main drag. Now, this is a quite interesting decision. It's as if there was a kind of national telepathy, as if everyone knew that a circulation riot was the thing, and to do it. Now, I don't want to exaggerate the threat to capital that poses. Even though capital has shifted more and more into circulation, I don't want to make some casual claim like, well, now you just need to block capital by shutting down choke points and it will collapse. I don't think that's quite as easy as it sounds. I don't think capital is going to go down that easy. But I think it's striking that the people of St. Louis and the people of Denver and the people of Oakland and the people of Kansas City all came to the same conclusion. And you can almost describe it as a desire that spread across the nation just to make everything stop, right? And that's one image of things stopping is the cars and the trucks on the freeway. And just like, we need to make it all stop. I think we're going to see more of that willingness to make it all stop. And that may be more blockades, more occupations, more barricades, but also more general strikes and more things that make it all stop. And the fundamental revolutionary question, if you want to get to that, is the moment when that can shift from being an interruption to an offensive struggle, not just to make it all stop, but to bring it all down. And those may sound similar, and we may hope that they're the same. We could just make it all stop, and then it will crumble. I think there actually will have to be a pivot from the blockade to something that's more of a direct confrontation and open struggle. And I think that's going to happen in my lifetime, maybe in your lifetime, quite likely. At some point, I promise.
I do want to get his defense of looting, because you remember he had this defense of looting. Was that a poem? Did you make a poem, defense of looting?
I should title a poem that about it.
The world needs that, right? And I know you like get this question every time you're interviewed, because it's just something that I think you have an answer to, where I think a lot of people on the anarchist and communist left may sort of like feel compelled with that position. I don't think that they've formulated it. And so, but you have. So do you mind telling us
the defense of looting?
Yeah.
So there's certain canards that people haul out after riots to try and discredit them. We know some of them. There's the claim that it's outside agitators, the claim that it has no point, that it's self-destructive. And one of the things people point to is looting, which does seem futile in certain ways. It does seem self-aggrandizing in certain ways. And people always sort of want to point to it as, well, the riot could have had a moral claim to something except for the looting. So two things about that. One, again, notice that reliance on the, we'll only accept the riot if it has the appropriate moral claim, a purely communicative logic that it needs to persuade people to it. Riots need a moral claim. Riots need to overcome moral claims. But the other thing I'll note is that the tradition of riot is the tradition of looting. If you go to that definition that E.P. Thompson provides of riots being struggles over the price of market goods, we see their history in medieval and early modern, let's say, England, as being over and over again about going to the bakery, or more often, blocking on the road a wagon that's transporting grain out of town during a time of famine, because people are hungry and they need the food to survive. And it costs too much for them to survive, and there's not enough of it. And so the things they do are demand the prices be lowered and demand that it not be sent somewhere else to be sold at a higher profit, but be given to the people in that county. So looting you can think of as a struggle over price, where the price you're setting is zero, right? You're saying, we need these goods to live, and that's what this struggle is about. And so looting is, in fact, not only the most common historical aspect of riot, but the most explicable and, in some sense, the most natural. Now, I will raise one problem with it, which is to say, if we're talking about, let's say, the 17th century, we have quite a different situation from the situation we have now. In the 17th century, the economy is near and the state is far, which is to say, the people who make bread and make goods are in your village. But there's no police. The police force doesn't exist. There's a couple constables at the most, or a beadle or something like this. All there is an army, and it's garrisoned elsewhere. So the economy is near and the state is far. Now we're in an opposite situation. The state is near. There's police on every corner. They're armed to the teeth. We know that, famously, the New York police force is the sixth largest standing army in the world, according to some measures. Whereas the economy is far. Things are made far away. They're produced elsewhere. You can loot. But it's only you can loot enough to get you through, what, a week, 2 weeks, a month? It's certainly not a long-term solution. So looting can't solve the problem. It can't answer the question that riot asks. But it also is inevitably part of what a riot is and a necessary feature of it.
What's the question that a riot asks? You said
the question a riot asks is...
I'm sorry, can we start again?
Yeah, we'll wait for the dog,
competing with you.
The question a riot asks is, rough, rough, rough.
He's looting. Okay.
The question a riot asks is, if it's now obviously the case.
Where's that slingshot?
Yeah, where's the slingshot? Yeah.
Someone stole it.
Somebody looted it, you mean?
Well, it's moving at least.
Okay.
The question a riot asks is, literally the timing is every time I hear the question.
Yeah, I know. That's so funny.
The question a riot asks is, if it's no longer the case that... The question a riot asks is, if we can no longer live by being sort of absorbed by capital, getting the wage...
Let's just keep going.
Yeah, let's do it last time and then we'll just make it artsy that way.
The question a riot asks is, if we can no longer expect to subsist in the world through the wage, through getting paid, getting what we need that way, how are we going to reproduce ourselves? And so more broadly, how can a community, a collectivity, a society reproduce itself without at the same time reproducing capital in a way that dominates it? And that's so that attempt to sort of separate from capital and reproduce yourself outside the wage, outside capital, that's the big question the riot asks, in a way that the answer we would say is something like the commune, right? Which is that way of a collectivity organizing itself so it can reproduce its own lives without at the same time feeding into the survival of capital, but separating itself from it entirely. And the riot really just wants to know what to do about that. And looting is one step along the way to an answer.
Amazing. Wonderful.
Yeah.
I think we got it. I want to do one more thing before we totally... Do you have any more questions?
Yeah, we got to do...
Room tone.
Absolutely.
So we're just going to stand for 10 seconds.
I'm familiar with room tone.
Hold on.
After my Daniel.
Do you have anything else you want to say? Because you said double riot. Is there anything?
I've got double riot in. We did Fanon.
We did Fanon.
Unfortunately, this dog is going to make it really difficult to get much more at this point. Every animal is up in arms right now.
Yeah, I don't think.
Feeding time.
I don't think I have anything else.
Yeah, no, we got very good ground.
Yeah.
Awesome.
We got very good ground.
I think this is the longest interview that we've done so far, like an hour and a half.
Yeah, it'll get shorter, I'm pretty confident.
Now we're going to run the whole thing.
Right. Straight through, unedited, fantastic.
I don't even know if I'm really a room tone with this guy.
Yeah,
but let's try it. So let's do 10 seconds room tone.
You got it?
It's a wrap.